If you notice on your bulletin, this is called a passion for prayer. Passion. Why do I not have passion for prayer? Sometimes it just seems like it's not working out for me. And I want that passion. But then I got to thinking, maybe I really don't understand prayer. I've really enjoyed the last two Sundays, the pastor preaching on prayer. And I think sometimes we just try to complicate it. And we don't want to make it simple. Really, praying is just talking to God. But no, we picked up a lot of books and we've read that you're supposed to be kneeling when you're praying. You should have your head bowed, your eyes closed. And if we're not doing those things for some reason, or we should be in a quiet time for 10 or 15 minutes, or you could extend that for 30 minutes to an hour, and for some reason we're not doing that, we get the idea that we just don't have passion for prayer. I want you to notice the scripture this morning in James chapter 5, verse number 16. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. You know what that word fervent means? It means passionately, with intensity, hot, burning, glowing prayer is what he's talking about in the scripture. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent, passionate prayer. Well, let me ask you a question. Do you pray like that? How is your prayer life? I think there's a couple things about prayer that really gets us confused. The first one is when prayer becomes problematic. When prayer becomes problematic, I think sometimes that just really confuses me. Now, we know we should pray. Most of us know how to pray. We know that it's something that is important to our lives. And yet, oftentimes, I look at it and say, well, you know, I didn't really get anything accomplished. I might have been driving down the highway, and I wasn't in a 10 or 15 minute quiet time. And so, it becomes problematic to me. Let me ask you a question. How big do you pray? How big do you pray? Do you pray big, thinking that you've got a big God that can answer big prayers? Or are we a little bit afraid of those? Prayer becomes problematic. It has in my own personal life because for so many years, I saw prayer in a physical sense or the mechanical part of prayer, kneeling, closing my eyes, bowing my head, instead of looking at it in a spiritual sense or praying from the heart. You see the difference? If I'm not acting it out, then I must not have passion for prayer. Now, my prayer life has been up and down all over the place in the last number of years. I've had prayers that have been very, very passionate. I've been praying when I was hurting so much that I prayed for hours. I've had prayers that have been funny. In 1975, my wife and I and our family moved to Washington, D.C. area to start a church. And that summer, my kids were in high school, freshman, sophomore, and junior. And so I wanted them to have a job. And so one of my boys was a friend with a guy, a kid in high school, whose dad had a souvenir stand downtown Washington, D.C. Had a big van. And the side of the van, there was a window that would open up, and he would sell T-shirts and all kinds of things out of that van. So I bought a two-wheel trailer, just a little old wooden trailer, and I thought, I'm going to fix a little souvenir stand for my boys to go down and make some money. So I put a little top on it and put little shelves in there, and they put dishes and hang T-shirts. And so when you go down into D.C., you have to go into the lottery and draw where you're going to be stationed, and either at the Capitol Building or up by the White House, up at Air and Space, or some of the other places. And so the very first day I took them down, I had this little red Mustang, and I drove them down, and hitched the trailer, and we drew Air and Space on the south side of the building. And so I left my three kids down there selling t-shirts and dishes, and I went on to do other things. I came back that evening to pick them up, to hitch the trailer back up to the car, and my kids said, "Hey, Dad, this guy that pulled in next to us, he's mad at you." And I said, "Really?" I said, "What's he mad about?" "He said that he's going to put you out of business." And I said, "Really? He's going to do that?" And he told my kids, he said, "If you sell those t-shirts for $14, I'm going to sell them for $13. You tell your dad I'm going to put him out of business." So I did all the All-American speech to that guy. He was from Greece. And he came to me, and we're standing on the street next to their space. And he said, "I told your kids I'm going to put you out of business." He said, "I want you to know right now, you're out of business." And I said, "Look, this is America. This is my spot." And I gave him that big old speech, you know. I thought it was pretty good anyhow. So I didn't think much about it, and we took the kids home. Next morning, we come down, and we draw in the lottery, and we get the Capitol building down by the reflection pool on the west side of the Capitol building. And so I pull the kids down there and unhitch the trailer, and I'm getting ready to leave, and in pulls this van right next to our little trailer. And this guy gets out, and I'm standing over by the reflection pool. He walked up to me, and he said, "I told you yesterday, buddy, I'm putting you out of business." Well, I started praying real hard, real, real hard, because I'm thinking mafia. I'm thinking guns. I'm thinking, do you mix a cement and being out in the Chesapeake Bay? That's what I'm thinking. And so he really let me have it. And I really prayed. And boy, he was hot. And he was red, and he was in my face. And I backed off a little bit, and I said, "Listen, guy, let me tell you what I'm doing." I said, "I have three teenage boys. It's summer. I want them to make a little money on the side." I said, "I came from Kansas to Washington, D.C. to start a church. I'm pastoring a church out there." And he looked at me, he said, "Oh, Father, I'm sorry." He said, "You stay right here." He said, "You sell everything, and I will move, and I will go somewhere else." And I'm saying to God, come on, let him have it. But that was a real experience. But it was funny. But watching God, to see how he worked in that situation, when it becomes problematic. You know, somebody said, if Satan can get us not to be present when we're praying, he wins. And I think, well, what does that mean? If Satan could get us to the place where we're not present when we're praying, he wins. Then I got to thinking, well, now I understand what he's talking about. There's a lot of times when I'm praying on my knees or wherever it may be, my head's bowed, I'm just not present. I'm not there wholeheartedly. We were talking in the prayer room there this morning in pastor's office that how many times has somebody been praying up here and you've been peeking? You've been looking at your watch, haven't you? "Yeah, I need to get out of here. There's a basketball game starting pretty soon." And so you peek. And so, you know, prayer really becomes a problem to us sometimes because it isn't like the way they say it's supposed to be. And so we have to overcome that. But the second part of that, not only does prayer become problematic, it's when prayer becomes possibilities. We don't know how to handle that. When prayer becomes problematic, but when prayer becomes possibilities, what does that mean? Do you realize that we are invited into the very presence of God to pray? We're not only invited, we are allowed into the presence of God. Think of the possibilities of that. Think of the passion that we could put into that if I can understand the possibilities that I have in my prayer life. You know, God tells us, and he calls upon us to be people of prayer, desperately depending upon him, the possibilities. How do we move from being problematic into my prayers and the possibilities there for my own personal life, for my marriage, for my family, for our church, whatever the situation may be? So why does the fire go out in our lives? Why do we not have that passion for prayer? What causes that? How do we rekindle the fire? You see, it's all about the fire. The fire within us. Why do I not have a passion for reading the Bible? Why do I not have a passion in my prayer life? It's all about the fire. In the book of Leviticus, and I'd like to read a scripture, Moses is instructing Aaron and his sons about the burnt offering, about the altar. It's found in Leviticus chapter number 6, 11 through 13. You'll see it on the screen. I want to read it to you. He gives them instructions. The altar is burning day and night. The sacrifice is placed upon that. There's instructions. That fire has to be tended to. You can't just let it be there. Someone has to attend the fire. And listen to the instructions given to Aaron and to his sons, the priests. And he shall put off his garment and put on the other garments and carry forth the ashes without the camp unto the clean place. And the fire upon the altar shall be burning in it. It shall not be put out. And the priest shall burn wood on it every morning and lay the burnt offering in the order upon it. And he shall burn thereon the fat of the peace offerings. The fire shall ever be burning upon the altar. It shall never go out. There's two things in that scripture that's important in this fire, the altar. The first one is you have to remove the ashes. Notice in the first part of that, he shall carry forth the ashes without the camp. The ashes, that residue left over after the fire is burning. It's the ashes that will smother the fire. It's the ashes that will let the fire go out, quench the fire. And so he's saying to them, you have to take the ashes out every night. And then secondly, he says, you have to put another log on the fire. That's an old song, isn't it? It should be in the Baptist hymnal. Put another log on the fire. That's theologically correct. Okay. He says you're supposed to take the ashes out, but you have to put a new log on the fire. Do you realize that works not only for the altar that he's talking about there, that works for your marriage. The reason our marriages don't have the flame and the fire and the passion within them is because we don't take the ashes out. We don't take the ashes out, the things that we said today, the things that we've done to another person, we just let them put the fire out. We don't put the ashes out. And then we don't put another log on fire. We don't put new fuel on the fire every morning. So that's the picture I want to present to you today. So why don't we have passion in our prayer life? Well, it's probably because the flame's gone out. It's probably because there's some ashes that we still have left in our life that we've not dealt with. It very well could be that we have not put another log on the fire in our spiritual life. And so I gave you an example of how it happens in a physical sense with a fire that's taking place, taking the ashes out and putting another log on the fire. But how does it happen in our spiritual life? And I'd like to take just a few minutes just to talk about how do I stoke the fire of my spiritual life. I grew up in an old farmhouse, and we didn't have electricity and had an old potbelly stove. And I can even remember my mom cooking with an old wood stove. I can remember we used to have to take the ashes out. We did that as kids. We had a place to take them. We had to take the ashes out. And you know, if we didn't do that, it would smother the fire. And so somebody had to tend the fire. And then we'd have to go out and get another log. And we put another log on the fire. We'd open up that little place where you put the logs in and place them in there, and then we had fire again. And so how do we stoke the fire of our spiritual life? You see, what I'd like to do is draw our attention not to prayer today, because that's what we've been talking about, is prayer. You know, I think about prayer being problematic. Have you ever gone on Facebook and somebody said, you know, I cut my finger with a butcher knife and I'm bleeding. Would you pray for me? And everybody said, praying for you. Prayer's going up. I'm lifting you up. And we just go down a big old long line. You know what I'm talking about. You've seen those, haven't you? You ever done that? And sometimes we might say, well, that's not praying. Well, it probably really is. Well, what really disgusts me is somebody comes along right in the middle of all that and they have to post a real prayer. You know, it's like that long. It's all in caps. And I'm looking at that. And they start out and said, oh, the God of creation, the God of this universe, and the God of Rehoboam and Jeroboam and all the little Boam kids. And man, they really get into it. And I'm thinking, come on, what are you doing to me? I'm a pastor. I didn't put anything on. I just said, praying for you. And so he said, well, is that praying? Well, if the heart's where it needs to be and it's ablaze, yes. But let me give you a scripture today that is just one that will change your life if you will allow it to do so. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 through 4. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ. Now I'm shifting from praying to my passion for Christ at this point. Because I don't believe that my problem that I have in the disciplines of Christianity, in praying and in reading the Bible and witnessing and going to church and giving, those disciplines, if I don't have passion in those areas, that's not really my problem. My problem is I don't have passion for Christ. And we're going to be talking about Him all this week. And we're going to be talking about the cross on Friday night, resurrection next Sunday, the passion for that and what we have in Him. And when that passion is like it should be, when I have a passion for Him, then my prayer will have passion within it. No matter how I'm standing, what I'm doing, but if I'm talking to God and I have a relationship with Christ and it's passionate, I guarantee you my prayer will have passion. Now look at this scripture. It's life-changing. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven. And so we have to refocus and we have to redirect our focus from prayer to put that focus upon Jesus Christ. He goes on, he says, you need to set your sights on the things of heaven where Christ sits on the place of honor of God at the right hand. Think about the things of heaven and not the things of earth. You see, that's what gets us in trouble. We think too much about earth. We think too much about the hurt that we have, the relationship that's not going like it should, the finances, I don't have the finances, and my eyes are just downcast upon my health and upon all these issues that we face in and out. And the first thing you know, it just dampens our spirit. If we don't have that spirit for Christ and that spirit to pray, and we don't even want to pray because we're looking at earthly things. And we don't live there. According to the Apostle Paul, he says, you've been risen. And think upon things of heaven, not upon things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. Man, I love that statement. Think about it. Your life is hidden in Christ. Absolutely nothing upon the face of the earth can ever harm you. Or you may say, you don't know how I'm hurting. You may be, but guarantee you, if you have Christ in your life, you are hidden in His life, and the devil himself can't touch you. If you understand the passion that you have for Jesus Christ, who died for you, gave His life for you, went into a dark, cold tomb for 3 days and three nights. And thank God, came forth in the resurrection. He lives today. And you're hidden in Him. That's the passion. And that's what Paul's talking about. But he doesn't stop there. How do you stoke a spiritual life? Well, first, you have to stir up the fire. Got to get in there with a poker. Stir it up. If you don't stir it up, God will probably stir it up for you. have to stir it up. But secondly, we've got to take the ashes out. Notice the rest of the scripture in Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, 8, and 9. Notice what it says. So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. But now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, dirty language. Don't do these things. Those are ashes. Those have to be removed. Notice he says they're lurking. These are the things that destroy us. These are the things that will not allow us to have the passion for Christ because they're lurking. Maybe not all of the things are we practicing, but I guarantee you in that list that we just read, there's probably something in there that is causing calamity in my life and are not allowing me to get where I need to go. So I need to get rid of some ashes. I have to stir up the fire and get rid of some ashes. That's sinful life. We have to eliminate the fleshly and worldly vices that smothers the flame. And so we don't have a passion for Christ because the sexual impurity, immorality, the anger, the greed, the rage, the things that we constantly are facing in the world are things that destroy that passion for Christ. And therefore, the reason I don't have the passion for prayer is because I don't have the passion for Christ. Take the ashes out. But, remember the song? Put another log on the fire. That's what we have to do. I'm not whoever sang that song, okay? Now, take out the ashes is the first thing that we have to do. But we also have to put another log on the fire. We have to establish spiritual virtues. We have to eliminate fleshly vices, but we have to exchange that to establish spiritual virtues. Let me read you this scripture, Colossians chapter 3. It's all in Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse number 1. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn and know your Creator and become like Him. You must clothe yourself with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults. You know, I find people out in the world do that oftentimes more than what people do in the church. We have to allow a little leeway for people's faults, according to this. And forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your heart. For as members of one body, we are called to live in peace. And so I have to add that to my life. I have to stir up the fire, my relationship with Jesus Christ. The way I do that is to take the ashes out, the vices, all the sin, add another log on the fire, and start adding love, tenderheartedness, forgiveness, those things. That's how you redevelop and to stoke your passion for Christ. You see, we're all theologians in the mind. We all have within our minds our doctrine of God, who we think He is. Even an atheist becomes a theologian, and he'll say there is no God. So we all have conjured up in our mind this God. We either see Him as a God that is good and a decent God, or we may see Him as a God that is unloving and really doesn't care. But that's our theological thinking, as what we think God really is. Now, that isn't what the Bible says about God, but that's what we think. And usually we think that God is somebody, when we try to picture him in relationship to who we are and what we're going through. And so we become these great theologians. Well, it just doesn't work that way. You have to understand who God is. How big are our prayers? Do we pray big? Do we pray big as a church? We're going to do that tonight. We're going to pray big. We're going to have some prayer requests in these punch bowls that people's going to put some big prayer requests in there, because it's a big and great and wonderful God. And so it's really not about prayer with a punch. It's really about our relationship with Jesus Christ and our passion for him. Now, I don't know everybody here today. I know some of you, but I have no idea what you may be facing today. What the pain might be. Maybe you're not facing something. Maybe everything's just perfect. Yeah, I wished it was. But I don't know what it might be. I really don't. But I guarantee you, some of us, and most of us here right now, have something in our life that is really crushing us. And I could say to you, well, just come to the altar and pray and walk away, and it's going to be taken care of. And it's probably not going to happen that way. But I can say this. If you'll just put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and who he is, whether you're saved or unsaved, Christian, non-Christian, whether you're going to heaven, not going to heaven, whatever terminology you want to use, this works for everybody. That Jesus Christ, that is the answer. When everything is right with him, then it'll be right with prayer. It'll be right with reading the Bible. Coming to church, you'll come to church with a passion. When you give, you will give with a passion. Why? Because of your passion for Jesus Christ. I've told this story many, many times of our little grandbaby that was born with water on the brain in 84, I guess it was. I think he'd be 31, 32 years old if he'd lived. But he lived to be 2.5 years old. And he was born just with the brain stem. And so we didn't think that he probably could ever see. His head was so large because of the fluid couldn't work its way out of the head back into the body that it smothered the brain from growing. And so, but we knew he could hear. And our son, his wife, went to camp one year out in Colorado, so we kept him. And Shirley and I were keeping him, I don't know if we kept him all week, but for a little while. And he would try to sit up, but he couldn't because his head was so heavy. And so when he sit up, we'd have to put a helmet on him, and he'd just roll back and different things like that. And here's a precious little boy, Rodney Cole. Best thing that ever happened to me. But one night, we had a fireplace, and a brick comes out. And he was over by that land and kind of tossing and turning. I was sitting on a couch, and he raised up, and he fell over and hit his head on that brick. And boy, he just started thrashing back and forth and back and forth and rolled through that dining area, that living room, and went out in the kitchen underneath the table. I could just tell you, I just sat there and I just wept when that happened. I didn't know what to do. So I got underneath the table with him. And he was laying underneath there. And I just got on top of him, put my arms around him. I got right in his ear. And I just started singing. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And that's the way I was singing to him. Little ones, to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. And I laid there for 10 or 15 minutes, and he got real quiet. And he laid there and listened to me. Listened to me. Jesus loves me. This I know. And I shared that with you this morning to let you know that Jesus loves you. Yes, He does. He loves the tar out of you. And no matter what it is you're going through, I want you to know you are hidden in Him if you're a Christian. If you're not a Christian, you can come today and that'd be a good place to hide. It's right there. You see, it's really about our passion for Jesus, not the prayer life. I've always come to the conclusion, if everything's right with Him, the rest of my spiritual life is going to be where it needs to be. See, we get it backward. We go to the bookstore and we pick up this book. Oh, I need to do this, need to do this, need to do that. I know this. Jesus loves you. And whatever it is that you're facing right now, He'll take care of it. And I pray if you don't have passion for Him, but Justin's going to come and I'm going to have a word of prayer, that maybe you might have some ashes you'd like to get rid of today, some things that's been holding you back. I don't know what it might be. I've got my own problems. Maybe you'd like to add another log on the fire. It has to be done. Listen, somebody has to tend the fire. And for your life, that's you. And for my life, it's me. Stand with me if you would. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you so much that we're invited into your presence. And Father, we're so grateful that we can come boldly to the throne of grace. Father, oftentimes we do have ashes that we're just afraid to get out of our lives. We know we shouldn't have them. For some reason, we think we can just sweep them underneath the carpet, but it doesn't work that way. And so, Father, maybe just for a few minutes this morning, maybe we could get rid of some ashes. Father, put another log on the fire, whatever that might be. Stir the fire. Father, thank you so much for what you've done for us. Father, what took place 2,000 years ago seems so far removed from where we're standing today. But it's as real today as it was on that day that they stood at the foot of the cross. But Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and he wasn't there, and then she saw him. Had seven devils taken out of her, but there she was. That's what you can do for us. So Father, I just pray you just take this moment. Some in our life we need to deal with it, we will do so. What a great time, Easter season. Father, thank you so much. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You know, Pastor Bruce will be up here and I'll be up here. You know, if you've got some ashes you might need to get rid of, need to put another log on the fire, hey, today would be a good time to do it.